life story is in keeping of the memory of Kenneth Byron Hale, only for his family and his generations thereafter. Ken, as most people called him, was born on a family farm on Tuesday, May 18, 1920. It was a partial solar eclipse that day, but his mother, Lucille Reed Hale, recalled the day with brightly shining sun, birds singing, and cherry trees in bloom outside the bedroom window. Herman B. Hale had a son. On July 4th of the same year, the community of Gaines Township had a baby contest, along with fireworks and baseball games. Little Kenneth won the healthiest baby contest and was awarded a blue ribbon. Father Herman was a rural mail carrier in 1923 and moved the family into town. Much spare time in those days was spent watching the roaring fire, the sparks flying from the anvil, and the water sizzling from the cooling tub of the local blacksmith shop. Dan the blacksmith amazed kids because of his ability to move about with a wooden right leg. Dan devoted many hours to the youth as leader of the 4-H Woodworking Club. Under his tutelage, young Ken won a blue ribbon for a lovely walnut serving tray. Ken's first recollection of the Great Depression of 1933 came while turning somersaults around the horse tethering rail beside the State Bank of Caledonia, Michigan. People were vainly trying to enter the bank, but were told it was closed indefinitely. Since his father was a rural mail carrier, the family had a regular, though modest, income. Entertainment in those days was what you made it. The Sunday school picnic at the park and the Hale Hall family reunion at Long Lake in Ionia County were great annual events. In the fall, the family would visit great-grandfather Benjamin Hall, Ken's maternal grandfather, at the fruit farm near Freeport, Michigan, to obtain a few bushels of Jonathan and McIntosh apples. The family carefully wrapped each one in newspaper and stored them in a barrel in the coal bin for the winter. Ken sold small jars of honey door to door, which his father collected from several beehives in their yard. One early enterprise was a local paper route of the Grand Rapids Herald. The paper route passed through the hands of Ken's siblings, Philip, Yvonne, and then Carl. He also was paid $1 a day to weed onions in a muck field. Quickly learning why no one wanted the job, Ken quit after his first day. The field was overgrown with nettles. A new gas station opened and Ken was hired to pump gas. In those days, gas was 20 cents a gallon. Then Ken started his own bike shop and became a popular go-to guy for repair work. There was little time to spare in high school. In addition to athletics, Ken was in a male quartet, men's glee club, mixed chorus, junior and senior plays, the annual operetta, debate team, played the trumpet, and tuba. Representing his class all 4 years on the student council, he became council president his senior year. Ken's third grade teacher was his most loved teacher. Hilda Echt emphasized qualities so important in life, including honesty, dependability, punctuality, and patriotism, which he honored throughout his life. Attending Michigan State was Ken's choice, since his parents, Lucille, Herman, and his grandfather, Elmer Hale, attended the Agricultural College. His best subject was chemistry, but he was attracted to law enforcement. The new curriculum was police administration, taught by the Michigan State Police. Ken pledged the Sigma Alpha Epsilon fraternity in the fall of 1939, probably because several of the upperclassmen were police administration students. While attending college, he stayed at his grandmother Reed's home, just across the street from Michigan State. A basketball team was formed with new residents from a huge rooming house. Ken joined their basketball team, winning a bronze medal intramural competition. Upon joining the ROTC, Ken was assigned a post at the foot of a stage by the Secret Service. First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt was to speak at the campus. When she departed the stage, she spoke to Ken, a memory he treasured. Meeting graduation requirements, Ken was to spend 1 week with the U.S. Secret Service office in Detroit, Michigan. By coincidence, the U.S. Secret Service was recruiting agent personnel at the time. Michigan State granted Ken credit for his remaining 2 months since he had been employed by a law enforcement agency. He graduated cum laude, a Bachelor of Science in Police Administration from Michigan State University. April 1942, Ken was to report to Anti-Aircraft Replacement Training Center, Port Eustis, Virginia. Dining with a college classmate one evening, Ken and the college classmate, John, met two young ladies, Erica Justice and Helen Hyde. Erica was on a student visa from Germany just after Hitler had completed the conquest of Poland. She was living with her aunt, Catherine Genowine Banco, and was employed as an obstetrician's nurse. Ken was immediately drawn to this pretty lady and was smitten by her French-German accent. They were married March 10, 1942 at Trinity Methodist Church in Washington, D.C. Aunt Catherine prepared a garden reception at her home with the help of Erica's Uncle Tim.
me about the good old days. Sometimes it feels like this world's gone crazy. Grandpa, take me back to yesterday, when the line between right and wrong didn't seem so easy. Lovers really fall in love to stay, stand beside each other, come what may. Promise really something people say, not just something they would say. Families really bow their heads to pray. Daddies really never go away. Oh, oh, Grandpa, tell me about the good old
somewhere in me.
would follow my heart someday. Thank you.
After a Florida vacation, Ken and Ricky decided to build a cottage in northern Michigan. It became a family haven, a paradise built in 1976. Ken's career was impressive, which included residence in several states as well as overseas and mingling with many noted dignitaries of the time. His career included service with the military, the U.S. Secret Service, professor of criminal justice at Indiana University, as well as chief of police of Indianapolis. His military career provided many opportunities to serve his country and was not in the least bit dull. He was assigned to the Intelligence Service G2, which duties included receiving copies of incoming intelligence reports from the Pacific area. A memorable event was plotting the Japanese fleet movements towards and leading up to the attack upon Attu, Alaska. Later, he was also involved in photo interpretation, translations, and interrogations of prisoners. His active duty career began in April of 1942 as a second lieutenant and ended in 1955 as a lieutenant colonel. After leaving active military, he again was employed by the U.S. Secret Service. He had an invitation to work for the CIA, but decided the Secret Service would be a better choice. He was assigned to many prestigious units to include the Truman White House detail. He was privileged to speak with and serve numerous dignitaries, including Eleanor Roosevelt, President Roosevelt, Prime Minister Winston Churchill, President Truman, Brigadier General Wallace H. Graham, President Eisenhower, President Kennedy, President Johnson, President Nixon and President Ford. During the Truman administration, he was returned to active duty in the military to participate in the wrap-up of the war crime investigations in Germany. He was instead reassigned to counterintelligence corps to supervise investigations relation to activity of the Jewish and Ukrainian displacement persons populations. By the time he again separated from the military, his medals included American Campaign Medal, EAME, Europe, African, and Middle East Medal, with two battle stars, Rhineland and Central European Campaigns, World War II Victory Medal, and Army of Occupation Germany Medal. On Ken's return from the military, he continued his employ with the Secret Service. He continued to serve his country, first in Detroit and then as an advance agent for Vice President Nixon on a goodwill tour to Latin America. In 1966, his daughter Judy was attending John Herron Art Institute, and both of Ken's sons were in the military. Tex was in the 81st Armament and Electronics Maintenance Squadron at an air base outside of London. Tom served as a demolition specialist with the 2nd Brigade, 1st Infantry Division at Dion, Vietnam. President Johnson was scheduled to go to Manila for a Southeast Treaty Organization conference. This gave Ken an opportunity to request assignment as an advance agent to one of those countries where Tom could get R&R leave. The request was approved, and Ken was able to see Tom in Bangkok, Thailand, and then fly to London to see Tex after his Secret Service duties to Johnson were completed. He ended his career with the Secret Service as Special Agent in Charge of the Indianapolis office. After 30 years of service with the Secret Service, he retired in June of 1971. He went on to recruit instructor, design courses, prepare lessons plans, as well as teach a curriculum for a certificate in corrections from Indiana Central University to be taught at both Indiana University, Purdue University, Indianapolis, and Indiana Central College. In the wake of a corruption scandal in 1974, Ken became Indianapolis police chief. After a series in the Indianapolis Star about department corruption, then-Mayor Richard G. Lugar asked for the resignation of Chief Winston L. Churchill and appointed Ken. He initially declined the offer since he was dealing with the actual death of his firstborn son, Ken Jr., Tex, as he and Erica called him. Tex was part-time deputy marshal answering a bank robbery call. Unfortunately, it was a false alarm, but his son didn't know this. The screaming siren from his car was wasted on the deaf ears of an oncoming truck driver. After reconsidering Mayor Lugar's offer, Ken accepted the appointment, hoping that diving into work would help heal the loss of his son. In a March 15, 1974 Star article on his appointment, Ken said, "I won't stand for anything less than complete honesty." In this capacity, he established an Alcoholic Anonymous program, established a firearms review board, and reorganized the department, just to name a few of his accomplishments. He left after 21 months to again try to retire. He continued to remain active in his community and twice served as president of the downtown Indianapolis Optimist Club. In the year 2000, Ken had ongoing battles with cancer and passed away on December 25th.